next speaker is from the company called 47 Degrees, and ask our next speaker about Lambda World if you want. It's a great conference, So the next talk is going to be about Freestyle, which is a library. And when we opened the call for papers and we reviewed all the talks that have been submitted, there were quite a lot of talks that have been submitted on the Free Monad, and one of the members of the program committee said, and I quote, "Oh, go and download another one." and we decided to pick one or two talks about Free Monad, but not too many, because Free Monads are a hot topic, so we wanted to have at least one, but they are a hot topic, so we didn't want to have five of them. Anyway, so Freestyle is a library that aims to make it easy for beginners to use the Free Monad. And before I pass the mic to Raoul, there's a brief announcement from 47 Degrees from...
Actually, he's going to intervene halfway through the talk, so...
Okay, I see. Well, then just take the mic. Okay, then please welcome Raoul.
Thank you. So yeah, first of all, before we get started, I'd like to get like a rough idea of like how many people are kind of like, you know, familiar with Free Monad. Nice. Yeah. How about Tagless Final Style? Okay. So Freestyle, it's a library that has been initiated from frustrations that we had kind of like trying to have beginners develop code in TypeDev. So there is like a very kind of like a spectrum of, I come from Java, I'm kind of learning Scala, I'm learning a few functional concepts, and then from there to I can successfully use CATS and all these type classes and abstractions to do TypeFP. It's a huge jump, right? So that has actually caused, in my opinion, that it's hard for people in Scala to adopt FP. And while Freestyle has some concerns around free monads and it's not the actual goal, we're gonna discuss that a little bit. So you might know, like, acquainted with FP because you have no previous category theory or math knowledge, and some of these abstractions seem unfamiliar to you, or you're living a style that you may be super unfamiliar with, like object-oriented programming in Java, or you come from a Python background or some other style. There's not a lot of docs, truly. So if you're like trying to embrace this style of programming, TypeFP, you're gonna find that even in GATS, which is one of the most used libraries, a lot of the data types are still not documented, or the examples don't really show you how to put all the pieces together. There's like individual examples about how to do this thing, and hopefully like Dave is gonna solve that problem with his book. And also, it's a very rapid changing ecosystem. So like, free monads are popular now, but they didn't come out like so long ago from the point of view of actual industry adoption or knowledge in Scala. So we keep seeing like these papers, and we are encoding those papers into libraries and trying to make sense out of them. And the reality is that sometimes like those encodings are not the most optimal for beginners to get started with and try to adopt this stuff. And also Scala itself, while being a language that allows you to do functional programming, it's a language also that has like some, in my opinion, some weird encodings for basic concepts that are kind of like at the core of TypeFP, like type classes, AETs, and so on. And furthermore, Scala is not like in Haskell where you have like some kind of like canonical IO type, so it's all over the place. People may find you might find people working just with Future as an IO, with FS2 task, or Moneyval task, or Scala set task, or now there's like an effort to actually provide one, which is in GATS FX IO. But there's a wide range of code bases that use different IO types to target, you know, their programs. And that actually is an issue as well, because you're learning, you know, certain techniques from one that do not apply to others. So what are Freestyle goals? The first one and most important is not simplify free monads, and it's not simplify tagless finals or any of those things. It's actually be a pro tool to newcomers. We want to provide a programming model that allows you to do pure FP, even if you don't know yet all of the abstractions necessary to get to that point. It's a stack safe by nature, and that's why we chose free as one of the encodings, and we have tagless finals with some modifications for stack safety as well. And we want to provide the simple integrations with Scala's library ecosystem. That means, like, for libraries like Doody and others, we want people that use Freestyle to seamlessly embed those programs in the flow of their applications without major integration hurdles. And finally, it's all based on algebras. So the core concept is that everything is modular, and you do not need to like depend on this huge stack to use certain functionality. You can use those as individual libraries that are completely decoupled from the core, or you can use the core as well if you want. So you don't have to even know that you're using free monads, or you don't need to actually build out the rest to use one of the freestyle libraries. So what we're gonna see in this talk is like what the programming style feels like, the main kind of core concepts within the core, the effects library and some of the effects and some of the integrations that we provide with other third-party libraries in Scala. And finally, we're going to talk about optimizations that we've done over the free monad and some of these encodings to actually make them more performant at runtime. Because we cannot forget that if we're using free monads and all these abstractions, there is like a considerable overhead that manifests itself perhaps in allocations, some other times in throughput. And if we're going to use these things in production, they got to be faster. So we're trying to like look at what the issues are and trying to kind of tackle each one of them at a time. And what's next for the library? We're going to talk about what we plan for the future and what Freestyle is going to become in the next few months, kind of like year time frame. So the first thing we are trying to achieve with Freestyle is that you follow like an interface implementation driven design. So this is something that Java developers and people that do not necessarily have an FP background are familiar with. They're used to creating interfaces, implementing interfaces, some kind of wiring happens, and they use those in their code. So we want that same paradigm to be also what they see when they want to do pure functional programming in Scala. So basically, it looks like this, right? So you have an interface, or a trait in this case, and you declare a set of operations. And those operations, then you just implement them somewhere else in a handler. Any questions so far? Feel free to interrupt me anytime, and I'll be happy to explain it.
What is FS? Is something?
Well, I'm gonna go on that in the next slide. So hold on that, and I'll show you what that is. So the first thing we do with Freestyle is like we do complete boilerplate reduction, and we are using metaprogramming. We're using macros to do that. So in this particular case, that would be the type of encoding you see below. Is what you usually get with encoding from data types a la carte. Are you guys familiar with data types a la carte, the paper? Okay. That paper basically says that if you have different monads, you can, or algebras, you can put them in a coproduct and then evaluate those. And that has, when you translate that to the free monad, has a lot of boilerplate because you have to have an inject type class that places the values inside the actual, inside the actual like coproduct. Right. Yeah, this is it's a good thing. I'll let you. All credit goes to Jorge Galindo. He got me that. So, so basically, okay. So for an algebra, you're gonna have to create an ADT, right? And then for that ADT, you're gonna have to provide smart constructors. Then those values get lifted from your ADT to the context of free. And because you're going to combine different algebras, you cannot use lift-f like we saw in the previous talk. You have to use the inject technique. And that requires an implicit instance. Furthermore, if you want to inject those algebras in other places in your code, you have to provide implicit instances of your smart constructor classes and some kind of mechanism in a similar way like Simulacrum does for type classes. If we want automatic dependency injection without a framework, we need that kind of blue code. So all of that is solved by Freestyle. The next thing we do is like when you have your algebras, well, first of all, if you notice, both in free and tagless finals usually have a carrier F higher kind type in the trait. And while that is something that is necessary to express that you're going to parameterize your entire program to a point where it's going to run to a set of stack monads. In this particular case, since we are using macros, there's no need for that, because FS can span a type, a path-dependent type, into free of F of whatever, and we can have the F synthetic for you. So that's like the kind of optimizations for the beginners that we're doing. It's like, if you're gonna create algebras, that is just noise, in my opinion, because that F doesn't tell you much of it, besides you having to carry that around in every single place. So we can materialize that for you. We also support, in the next iteration, we're gonna support that if you are more of like an expert programmer and you wanna carry on with the F, that's fine. It'll be just ignored by the macro. The other thing we do is like we wanna take all your algebras and make modules out of that. And that actually eliminates a lot of boilerplate. So if you're familiar also with data types a la carte and free, you're gonna see that once you have a list of algebras, like in this case exercise of, user progress. This, by the way, is like code from Scala exercises. So these are actual algebras in the Scala exercises project. You end up having to create a coproduct, then place the algebra 1 and 2, because coproduct is a binary type constructor. And then you have to keep on partially applying that type until you have your entire coproduct tree of all the algebras that you can interpret. And you have to do the same with the interpreter. So if you define individual interpreters for each one of those algebras, you're going to have to like, kind of like, in this case here, can I use it again? Kind of oral each one of them. And they have to align perfectly the shape of the coproduct on the type definition as well as in the runtime definition. There's some implicit ways to alleviate that, and we use that as well in freestyle. But that's something we completely get rid of. So what you do is basically just define a module and define vowels inside the module. And those are implicit as well, so they get automatically injected and you can just use them. Modules and algebras allow for concrete methods, so you can declare further concrete methods in your application. I'm gonna try to be quick because I don't have much time. So, in this particular case, we support both free and tagless, so they are defined exactly the same way, so you don't have any kind of like cognitive overhead about learning the different techniques. You just change the annotation. And then when you are trying to mix tagless programs with free programs, we provide stack-safe representations of the tagless algebras that you can combine in your program at any point. So you can, your model, you say validation was defined as tagless because in, for some reason I want this kind of performance or no overhead from the free monad. I can, if I want to combine it with the free program, then I can just like bring in the stack safe representation. And building programs is just like any other monadic flow. You implicitly require any of your algebras, which are automatically wired. You don't need to provide the methods to do that. And you just use them as if they were a monadic flow. They're all in the same monad, so you don't need transformers, just like use them as is. And then finally, when you want to run them, you potentially want to run them to, say, future or any kind of interpreter. You can run anything to any target type. And in this case here, we're running to a transformer stack with state T because we have purely functional state, we have potentially concurrency or asynchrony from task, and then we're logging some stuff. So all of your algebras in your program declaration, they don't need the transformer stack or have any knowledge of it, just on the at the point where you actually run it. So once you are on a program, it looks like this. If you notice app here, was before a module, which united all the algebras, and it had like a synthetic member, which is the final coproduct assembled for you. And you can just say, I want to interpret my program to this coproduct or module. And then you can start unfolding the stack that you declared before. So if you have state, whatever, then you have first your state, then you run the state, then you have the task, then you run the task, and you have the final body. So it encourages a programming style where you don't run anything at any point until the end of the application. You build and declare programs that at some point in your application, like main method or controller, they get reduced to the final body. And that opens the door for you in testing to use any interpreters or different interpretations. we have an effects library. I'm gonna just like fly through this. We implement most of the common like MTL style effects like error, option, validation, and those are alternatives to mono transformers. You don't need to use them, but they are there for people that are used to working with effects or with MTL style. So we have either, error, option, writer, and all of these, when you use them, just like pass a value to them. If it's biased to the success, you'll get the binding on the left. Otherwise, your program will either short circuit or provide some other effect. And we have integrations with a bunch of the Scala libraries, Monix, Fetch, FS2, Dewey. You can run streams on the monadic flow. You can use Dewey programs right directly on the monadic flow without any manual lifting. The same for Slick. We have NTD Marsalis ready for IKEXDB and most of the common web frameworks like Play, Twitter, Util, Finch, and all those. And basically that allows you to have like a purely functional program in any framework, and then once you return the value, the right Marsalis apply, run the interpreters to the expected framework target type, and it just works. So you don't have to worry about the glue code to deal with those frameworks. For the integrations, this is what our integration will look like. So if you're integrating Dewey inside Freestyle, you will just create a tray for the actual type that Dewey uses for its program, so in this case, Connection.io. We write a handler, so it's the same programming model, both for integrating libraries and for distributed libraries and applications. And once we have that handler, we can just run it to obtain the final interpreter or target M. And then we provide also like type classes that allow you to completely lift any syntax from other frameworks, like in the case of Dewey, SQL queries right in line back to the context of Freestyle in a very simple way. So in this case, like if you were using Dewey with Freestyle, you could just require the Dewey algebra we just like built, and then you can run your SQL straight up on your monadic flow and then get the value on the left side without any further. And we have optimizations. Like I mentioned earlier, like this approach of data types a la carte has some issues, and it's mostly, there's no issues really in the actual concept or science behind it. It's just like accidental kind of like complexity from the fact that we're in the JVM, and some things like take different performance hits than others. So we're optimizing this, and the way we're doing this, we're using IOTA, and I'm gonna let Andy very quickly tell us a little bit about it.
So if you imagine most co-product implementations, they're typically implemented as a binary tree at the value level. So if you're gonna extract a value that's deeply nested in a co-product, that requires a series of match statements to traverse that binary tree. So immediately, if you have an algebra that's fairly deep in a co-product structure, then it's fairly, there's overhead associated with retrieving that value. So we avoid that entirely by having a coproduct that is simply a single value and an index stored that is associated with a type list. So instead of being the binary tree, it's just an immediate lookup to interact with that coproduct. Additionally, if you're familiar with using coproducts with natural transformation, when you're building an interpreter for that coproduct using CATS, it's joining together a series of interpreters for the individual algebras, and it does that by sequencing a bunch of match statements. So we also match on the index value and then delegate to the respective interpreter for each individual algebra immediately. And we do that with a JVM switch statement by using the switch annotation from Scala. So you get much faster delegation to your interpreters instead of having to deal with the overhead of, right. So. I don't know how many this evaluates to. We did some tests, some preliminary benchmarks of the overhead associated with evaluating co-products of many algebras. This is just the overhead, so it may be very, very small compared to the cost of running your computation. But for the overhead of getting through the switch statements at about 17 algebras, the CATS implementation is halves in terms of performance. So it's twice as much overhead with 17 algebras. And you can imagine in Freestyle, where we want to combine algebras from many different modules, we don't want any of that additional overhead. And this allows us to circumvent that. IOTA is shown at the top, and it's constant. It's constant at the at runtime, and also compile time, it's very, very fast. There's no additional bloat. It's done with macros, so it's very, very fast at compile time. And we have some tests where we have 300 plus algebras compiling almost instantly, and then also evaluating in constant time at runtime. So same thing happens at in freestyle, where we use a JVM switch statement when evaluating the operations for the generated handlers. You noticed on one of the earlier slides, Raul had different methods that he was implementing. When the interpreters are evaluating for those, to delegate to those methods, it's also using a JVM switch statement to delegate to those very quickly.
And a lot of casting and assist, that's all.
That's all hidden with the macros. You can go see the code, it's there. Thanks.
And the other thing we provide is like for the tagless encoding, like tagless by default, unless you are interpreting to a stack safe mono such as, I don't know, like feature or free, it's not going to be a stack safe. So if you have a program that is like not even that huge, you can potentially like interpret to option or something and get a stack overflow. So we provide a way for you to just say, for a regular interpreter that is not considering anything regarding stack safety, maybe an interpreter that goes to option, for example, just to automatically get a stack safe representation of that. And that basically what it does is, for that interpreter, lifts the values previous to the computation to free of option of A. So there's a jump on the, that trampoline step that guarantees the stack safety of a tagless program regardless of the interpreters, how they are built. What's next? We're going to have more integrations with more libraries, more syntax and runtime optimizations. We are migrating our macros to Scala Meta to get into the idea support, because that's basic for new beginners. Like, one of the reasons why people don't adopt Scala is not sometimes I/O, or it's not sometimes documentation, it's because IntelliJ doesn't do a good job with like complex types and macros and this kind of meta programming. And they use IntelliJ and want to change. We're building libraries around it, and the point is of freestyle is that it's not a way to reduce free monads or tagless final boilerplate. It's more of like a way to build libraries with the same kind of like mechanism, which is declare everything in algebras, provide interpreters, then have ways for them to run it. And that opens the door of when you create a library for users of your library to, at any point in time, declare an implicit interpreter that changes the behavior. So everything you've declared in your library is completely overridable. We're also working on a Kafka and Cassandra client, and we're working on this because we need them for actual work and what we do daily. We're going to open source those as well. And we're working, it's not going to be a full-blown like RPC or microservice framework like Lagoon or some of the other ones, but a very easy way for you to take out your rest and then turn them into endpoints or potentially allow for distribution of computation with this programming style in a very easy way. It's inspired by CATS, because we use CATS, so it's like a companion library for CATS, and you can still use all the CATS type classes and everything with freestyle. And also inspired in Simulacrum. What Simulacrum is to type classes, we are to free monads and tagless in a way. So we try to provide the same kind of like boilerplate reduction and implicit machinery. And also, of course, it's inspired by other great libraries that do similar concepts in terms of like using free and sensible effects, such as F and Freak, which takes the opposite approach of ADDs first versus meta first. And while I'm here talking, this is by no means my project. This is kind of like a lot of people that are contributing to this thing, and 47 Degrees is kind of like a sponsoring in a way. So we have all of these great contributors that made the first couple of releases possible. I invite you to go to free.sio, try it out. We are 020, and most of the stuff that I commented here, it's already available to play with. And that's all I have. Thank you.